And we welcome you back for our final game in our triple header coverage today at the AAU State Championship here at Bloomington Jefferson High School. Mike Peden and Don Ackerman with you. It's the junior division featuring North Tartan 11 EYBL and Minnesota Fury 2017 Elite. We'll talk a little more about the players to watch in a moment, but let's go down to the floor for the announcement of our starting lineup. So there's a bit of a mix-up we'll have to sort out here because Mikayla Hayes was listed as 23. She's wearing 24. And there's another 23 who is not listed. So we've got a little bit of sorting out to do. But a lot of recognizable names on both rosters here. Dee Dee Winston, a Hopkins student. Temi Sarda, Lakeville North. Rachel Ranke from Eastview. This is on North Tartan's team. Mikayla Hayes from the two-time state champion Park Center Pirates. Mariah Sexe, a strong post player for Eastridge, and Carmen Backus, who is a standout at Chisago Lakes. And as we get underway, North Tartan wearing the navy, Minnesota Fury wearing the baby blue. And in the Fury's case, Lindsey Theuninck, one of the leading scorers last year in high school ball. Danielle Schaub, also from the Park Center Pirates. And our first basket of the game belongs to number 11, Madison Monahan. Annika Jank from Edina is another one. And Eden Nibbelink. Also a notable name. Fury draws the foul. It's Riley Wheatcraft who will go to the line.
Foul on Moynihan. Or Monahan. I've heard it said both ways tonight.
Riley Wheatcraft makes the front end. And the back end. So that gets Fury on the board. Riley Wheatcraft from Prior Lake, Minnesota. Mikayla Hayes, who has announced her verbal to Florida, will sign her letter of intent next school year. Goes inside, and Madison Monahan will shoot two.
Foul on Wheatcraft. So both players who have scored have also fouled.
They're consistent.
Or involved.
Consistently involved.
Yes. You win, Mike. Misses a second.
Monahan makes one of two, makes it a 3-2 score. Madison Monahan, a member of Glencoe Silver Lake. And a nice bank shot from Annika Jank going up on Mikayla Hayes. And Hayes at 6'1", not an easy post player to get around. Three on the way, that's off the mark from Temi Sarda. Sarda from Lakeville North, as we noted. Lakeville North, also the home of Rachel Banham. Danielle Schaub finds Jank. Jank out of Edina. Tough shot, can't put it in, and a foul is called. It's on number three, Lindsey Theuninck. Theuninck, a member of Mankato Loyola. And Theuninck led the state in scoring last year, edged Suzanne Gilreath in that figure, and could win the state scoring race next year. Offensive foul is called on North Tartan. Push foul.
They called that on Backus, I think, right?
They didn't announce it, so I'll take your word for it. 3 on the way. That's short with the attempt was Theuninck. And diving for the rebound was Sarda. There's Backus. Backus goes up and scores. Backus, the daughter of Michelle Backus, the team chaplain for the Minnesota Lynx, and Michelle also an assistant coach at Chisago Lakes. So they take basketball and theology quite seriously in the Backus family. Michelle is one of the leaders for the team's Faith and Family Night as well, I should add. Schaub goes up, and we spoke about teammates going against each other in our last game. We have that here with Danielle Schaub going up against Mikayla Hayes as number 23 hits the basket. I'm going to get that name at halftime. So number 23 has 2 points. We have no idea who that is yet. Schaub goes to Ellie Guess. Corner three is short. That came from Wheatcraft. And the rebound by the player of mysterious origin. She finds Mikayla Hayes, and she can't lay it in. And the layup on the other end going to Annika Jank. This is a style of play Jank isn't used to at Edina. Nice bounce pass. And Mikayla Hayes with the finish. The assist goes to Temi Sarda. Mikayla Hayes, the daughter of Dana Joubert Hayes, a former Golden Gopher. Graduated in 92. Mikayla Hayes, as we noted, will go to Florida. Schaub, the youngest of the Schaub sisters, finds an opening, but Wheatcraft can't put it in for three. Offensive rebound. Annika Jank in one. Annika Jank with a strong impression in the opening minutes. 11:36 to go, and Minnesota Fury. Well, we see the line change. Well, we're seeing line change subs everywhere.
And since we've watched the 9th grade, 10th grade, now watching the junior, you can really see the difference in the games. You're seeing the three-pointers that do not go in are hitting rim or very close. They're not really missing everything like we saw earlier. And you're seeing a more offensive or a more mature offense being played. Ooh, nice.
No, number 23 has 4 points. I'll get it, if all else fails, I'll get it at halftime, but I'm almost hoping one of these teams will call a timeout so I can race down there, down to one of the scores and figure this out. But it's 11-8 with 11-11 to go, and the steal by number 4 of North Tartan, Raina Johnson. Faking the three is number 22, Drew Gilton. Johnson, up and under, can't put it in, and the rebound by 53, Sydney Wierke. Jolene Danninger, number 1. Wierke. Back to number 5, Eden Nibbelink. Well, number 23 is not doing a very good job of staying inconspicuous. 4 points and a steal. And that was actually number 22 blocked by Wierke. Gilton couldn't put it in. Tori Martell finds Wierke for the bucket. Wierke is on the board. 11-10. North Tartan over Minnesota Fury, but this has been the closest game we have seen in the three games we have covered today. Sarda went for Gilton and she couldn't hit the three. Rebound and put back by number 25, Mariah Sexe. Sexe out of Eastridge. Yes, her last name is pronounced that way, and I'm sure she's heard every joke in the books. But at Eastridge, she and Noelle Tomes have formed a good 1-2 combination. Eastridge hovered around the top 10 last year in the state rankings. And with those two coming back, Eastridge will be a team to watch coming out of the Suburban East.
And I've done the book at many, many, many games for my daughters. And doing the book from way up here, not being able to see the refs and who they're calling on, makes it very hard to do statistics. It's very interesting. It's perspective. It's nice being up here to see the plays develop, but it's not as nice when you have to try to figure out what the refs are yelling or really not yelling at all.
Sexe completes a three-point play, making it 14-10. North Tartan over Minnesota Fury. Using up the dribble was Danninger. And she had to fire a tough shot. Sexe with the rebound.
She did kind of spin around there. I was wondering if they were going to call the travel myself. It was kind of a prayer of a shot. Didn't go down this Sunday.
Raina Johnson, tough shot. Rebound and no three-pointer from Estella Moschkow.
Now they got a foul.
And it's on North Tartan. It's on Ranke. Well, no, not on Ranke. I don't see number 12. Missing was number 21, Wheatcraft. And there is Dee Dee Winston out of Hopkins. She drives and is blocked. Danninger comes up with a steal. Deep three, off the mark from Tori Martell. Sexe with another rebound. Another deep three, also off the mark, this one from Drew Gilton.
But again, just off the rim.
Right, they're getting rim, so it's not a matter of fatigue or shooting motion. Coming up with a block there is number 30.
Some of the shots
Moschkow.
Not going in is really all about the defensive effort, the pressure that the opponent is putting on them.
And this back and forth affair continues while Dee Dee Winston fouls Danninger. And Danninger will shoot two. And we're going to see some subs come in for North Tartan. Monahan, Lindsey Robson, and Sarda will all go back in. And Hayes will sub in after the shot. Schaub going back in for Fury along with Guess, Theuninck, and Jank. Apparently this platoon thing is
popular.
Yes, very popular. 14-10 as Danninger missed both free throws. North Tartan with a 4-point lead. Nice high low, and Sarda will shoot a pair. That was a quick high low. That was a laser pass. And Sarda, who has yet to score, will go to the line. Sarda, one of the leaders at Lakeville North. Team that hasn't recaptured the glory from their days with Rachel Banham and that post player that comes to... Oh, geez, I'm drawing a blank. I'll think of it, though. Danager goes up and comes up short. Rebound Hayes. The other player I was thinking of for Lakeville North was Cassie Rochelle, once the record holder for most blocks in the state. Deep three for Danninger. That's off the mark. Apparently, we don't need the high school line.
Nope, optional. Well, sometimes the defenses are actually built around that line, so if you can shoot from behind it, you can get yourself a wide open shot without anyone trying to get in your way.
Steph Curry, ring a bell?
Yep. He's making that famous, but that's nothing new.
No. It's just easier when you can make shots regularly from that far out. Three-pointers missing everywhere. Moshkow with the rebound.
Yeah, I wonder how the coaches feel about that. Is that their regular game?
Hayes can't post up.
Early on, it looks like they were feeding the post. Now they've kind of gone away from that until just now.
16-10 with 6:15 left in the first half. Schaub to Jank. Over to Theuninck. Guess in trouble. Traveling violation.
We're calling the travel because she moved while she was on the ground.
And that goes against Monahan, but she did get the deflection, and if she were on a Cheryl Reeve team, she would probably get props.
And she got them from her coach, as she should. As
she did all she could. Just that happens sometimes. Schaub to Jank. Jank in trouble. Schaub going up against her teammate there.
Okay, they're double teaming.
Schaub, I think, was trying to call timeout. And the timeout is granted. Well, maybe you can offer your observations while I try to figure out who number 23 is.
Thanks, Mike. Mike's running down to get that, to find out who our missing, our known, unknown player is. I should have given him the score sheet take with him so he could find out who that is, but he's on it right now. 16-10 with 5:39 left. There we go, Mike's getting the score sheet right now.
I can confirm now that Drew Gilton is wearing number 23, not 22, and wearing number 22 is Rachel Ranke, who was listed as 12. So now we've got that cleared up for you. Meanwhile, the Fury are trying to rally back from a six-point deficit and still not hitting the threes. Guess with the miss, and we're going North Tartan's direction.
Foul on 21.
So Ranke is 22, Gilton is 23, and Hayes is 24. Gilton, by the way, is from Rapid City, South Dakota.
Another player playing outside their state.
Well, that's, again, just another piece of evidence on the reach that North Tartan has. They attract kids from all over the Midwest.
Absolutely. I wonder how that works for practices and weekday events.
I mean, it has to be they have to be making a big commitment. The kids and their families, as Hayes comes up short there.
Maybe a family in town.
Carmen Backus gets the old board. She'll take the three. Bullseye! Coincidentally, this is the first time I've seen Carmen Backus play. I've known about her for a couple of years, but she's making a good impression thus far. She has 5 points. Hayes with the rebound there. North Tartan on the run. Mid-range J is short from Sarda. And the rebound goes to Daniel Schaub, all 5 feet, 5 inches. Tried to set up Theuninck for three, can't get it done. Backus with the rebound, trying to hook up an outlet play. Sarda with the finish.
Nice pass by Robson on that play.
And Fury with another timeout. And the two North Tartan teams that we have seen, the 10th grade team and the 11th grade team, are very fluent when it comes to fast break plays. They now have an 11-point lead with 4:29 left in the first half. Sarda. That's her first field goal. I take it it's been a while since you were last a statistician.
It's hard to watch a game
and think about notes.
And take notes and try to figure out what you're going to say. Because, Mike, you put a lot of pressure on me to keep up with you.
Well, you're the one who came with a notepad. You came prepared. I should be the one taking flack for not thinking about that. But I do use score sheets when I go to games, as you've seen, so I know what you're going through, trying to keep up and then keep an eye on everything. That's what high school ball or AAU, you know, it's not as fancy or as elaborate as college or pro, where you can just look at a monitor and have all the stats fed to you.
Yes, yeah, it's definitely impressive what you do, and then this is not an easy job, and just like it isn't very easy to be a referee and call everything and see everything correctly.
And it certainly hasn't been easy for Minnesota Fury, as North Tartan has scored the last 10 points. A 10-0 run builds a lead from 1 to 11.
And I think we're seeing a lot of unforced deep threes, and I don't know if that's what the coach is asking them to do.
Hayes tips the rebound to herself. Raina Johnson goes to Backus. To Drew Gilton, back to Johnson. Hayes goes up, no good. Rebound, Wierke. Fury trying to go outlet. And unable to get the finish was Wheatcraft. That's tough. Hayes goes up, misses again.
Both good shots though.
Well, Hayes knows what to do in the post. Wierke this time gets a fast break play to fall. Hayes knows a thing or two about post play. She's the only post player at Park Center, so she's used to doing a lot of dirty work down low.
And she looks really comfortable there, and she's doing well. The puck is just hitting off the rim.
She also got a few tips from her mother.
There we go. Nice rebound.
Goes up.
Again, right off the rim.
And now she commits a foul. So three straight misses for Mikayla Hayes.
Wow.
And she fouls Riley Wheatcraft in the process. Both teams out of fouls to give with 3:09 left in the first half. That last basket by Wierke ended the 10-0 run from North Tartan. Martell used up, or didn't use up the dribble, thought she did. Ends up throwing it away to Gilton. Gilton, oh, can't hook up with Johnson. Johnson wasn't ready for the pass and a foul. On Johnson, so a double whammy. Raina Johnson. And with both teams out of fouls to give, 1-1 for Tori Martell. And that's something we haven't seen too much of in the first two games, making the front end of a 1-1.
Yes.
And on the stoppage, we also want to send our thanks to Dave Preller for allowing us to come here and televise a few games from the state championship, considered one of the most prestigious events on the AAU calendar. And an offensive foul is called.
Johnson.
Back-to-back fouls on Johnson. It has not been a great 30 seconds or so for number four. 2:38 left in the first half. An 11-point lead is down to 7. Martell made both free throws, by the way. Oh, a nice fake to get out of the jam. No basket. But a three-pointer for Ellie Guess, number two. So Nibbelink missed down low, and now North Tartan calls a timeout. I guess that miss didn't hurt so much. 30-second timeout. what was an 11-point lead is down to four with 2:12 in the first half. What have you noticed from the Fury team in these last few minutes?
I was just thinking about that myself.
They left you speechless.
Well, collecting the free ball and grabbing the quick three, that's the kind of thing that can make a big difference. Other coach shows you how important those 3 points are by calling a timeout when to refocus and try to collect a state championship.
And how does North Tartan regain their composure? Because Raina Johnson looks a little out of sorts here.
Yeah, I
two fouls, a turnover, and
but I think you can see how good of a player she is because the coach leaves her in, and actually she's the first one to touch the ball after the timeout.
And that has fueled this 7-0 run for the Fury, which ends right there. Estella Moschkow with the first basket.
Yeah, it's interesting the Fury have cut it so close because they were taking some threes, and I was kind of wondering, are these unnecessary? Someone's open, but still, are you going to run an offense? And it's now they've missed those threes, and they're in the game.
There's a difference between taking a quick three and a design three.
Exactly.
Three on the way from Ranke. Off the mark. Eastview, another perennial, by the way. Raina Johnson gets a triple.
And keeping her in the game paid off for a coach.
So North Tartan with a quick 5-point burst. And Martell can't end it. Edina Nibbelink, by the way, number 5 for the Fury. I'll get to that point in a moment. Johnson with the O-board. Ranke goes baseline, too strong. Rebound, free throws coming for Mariah Sexe out of Eastridge. I was going to say Edina Nibbelink goes to Winona, who made the state semifinal round in the Class 3A tournament this year. Winona beating Grand Rapids before losing in the semifinal. Or actually went to the championship, that's right. Sexe at the line makes the first. And Winona making their first state tournament appearance in 13 years and ended up getting crushed by Holy Angels in the 3A title game, but always good to see some new faces get in there. And Mariah Sexe hopes to do just that next season for Eastridge. In the 4A bracket, misses the back end. That puts Sexe up to 4 points. And another foul on Raina Johnson. That's her third. And more free throws coming for Fury. Tori Martell, who made two free throws, will go to the line. This is 1-1. Makes the front end. Misses the back end. Tori Martell out of Somerset, Wisconsin. Reached 1,000 points last year. And Martell has verbal to play at Montana State next year. And throughout these games, that's the most fascinating facet I find with AAU basketball. All of the Midwestern players coming outside of Minnesota that want to come here and get some playing time. And as you know, Minnesota has become a hotbed for both boys and girls basketball over the years. Our state is known for its hockey reputation, but we can hoop too.
There's a lot of good basketball happening.
20 seconds to go in the first half. North Tartan up by 9, make it 11 and possibly 12. A 3-point play chance for Lindsey Robson.
That time they announced who called the foul. That was nice.
Robson completes a three-point play. A 9-1 run for North Tartan to respond to the 10-0 burst from Minnesota Fury. But they still have time. Jank goes up and lays it in. 3 seconds. D.D. Winston from deep. Oh, that was close.
That was really close.
Well, even the deep threes are close. But North Tartan will take a 10-point lead for this brief intermission. 30-20 is our score. And now that we have our identity crisis figured out, who do you think has been riding low for our two teams in this game?
What does that mean?
I'm referencing the song choice.
Sorry, Mike. I was trying to understand.
I guess you and I are going to have to go to war over music trivia now.
I hadn't heard the song. I was too busy adding up all the scores for everybody.
A very balanced effort for North Tartan, though, as you tabulate the figures.
Absolutely.
All but two players have scored, Rachel Ranke and Dee Winston. Carmen Backus is the leader with 5 points. Sexe, Gilton, and Sarda have 4. Johnson, Monahan, and Robson have 3. And then Hayes with a pair. I mean, that just tells you how deep this North Tartan team is.
Yeah, and I think on the Fury side, you've got Jank has looked very impressive, but not really like she's dominating the game, but she's making every chance she gets count. And so she has 8 points, but not in a way where you'd think, oh, they're trying to feature her. But you know, she's getting the ball down low, and she's able to use her length to scoop the ball and get some shots that go in and give her points.
Wierke with 4. And what do you think the second half is going to come down to?
You know, I think if the Fury, if that 3-point shot that they were trying earlier is part of their game, if that starts dropping, that could make a big difference to them in a 10-point game.
And for North Tartan, obviously you'd love to keep this balance up where your leading score is 5 points, and in any other scenario, that wouldn't be a good thing here. It just means there's plenty of options on the offensive side.
Yeah, I start thinking to myself, if I'm the Fury coach, what am I supposed to focus on? I guess I'm going to focus on us. I can't really focus on them because there's nobody there I can key on. I just need to focus on us playing good team ball, working together, and keep in mind that they are distributing well and that they are getting a distribution as far as points go. I need to focus on us making our shots, making good shots, and getting back in this game.
You wonder if they've been taking a page or two out of the Lynx playbook? Just stack the roster?
I'm telling you, if I'm playing the Lynx, I don't know what to do. Well, I mean, who do you shut down? On any given night, a different player is going to beat you. So,
We've seen that in 2 games. Even Natasha Howard, I didn't mention her earlier today, put up a solid effort in the Chicago game.
Absolutely. Yeah, you just sit there and think to yourself, man, this is impressive.
And with North Tartan, it's the same thing.
They are.
I mean, nobody's really stepped up to be the leader, but the scary part is any of them could in the second half.
Absolutely, yeah. They can all be dangerous shooters.
Or they could all contribute equally like they did in the first half and take the route of Indiana where you have 7 players in double figures. Indiana's done that twice in back-to-back games.
Yeah, and I've seen Lindsey Robson play before. She's actually a pretty, very good deep threat, a three-point set. She has 3 points on the and one that she got down low, but she's a player who can hit threes. So we haven't really seen North Tartan do a lot of three-point or have been very successful with their three-point shooting. But if they're able to, if they want to focus on that, if to keep up with the Fury, if they start making theirs, I have a feeling they could accomplish a lot there as well. So I don't really know what the Fury is going to do in the second half. It'll be interesting to see. They get the ball first to start it off.
Well, it's time to get furious.
Oh, boy.
Jank, blocked by Hayes. Rebound, Backus. Tried to go outlet, and Sarda finishes the job. Sarda up to 6 points. The pass was tipped, but Sarda with a nice recovery there. Schaub to Jank, and Danielle Schaub, the defense of her and all the other members of her class were instrumental in Park Center's state championship 2 years ago, the first time they faced Marshall. And it was a glimpse of just how talented that group would become. It was a freshman group that got Park Center through all 3 overtimes to come out with their first state title as their top player, Caleb McMorris, fouled out.
Tartan's defense has been showing itself really strong. You can see that they're focused on keeping the Fury down.
Schaub kicks out to Theuninck. Now Jank.
You know, what's really interesting is as the play continues, you almost feel like they have a shot clock in their head.
Theuninck with their first basket of the game. It's a three-pointer. It's a nine-point margin now, 32-23. And a foul on Schaub. Drawing it, Madison Monahan.
I was going to say, as the play continues, you see people, you can start to see a little anxiousness, and it's interesting because there is no shot clock. You don't have to be anxious. Just keep working until you get what you want. But you see people kind of speed up and try to do something, and you don't have to.
Draining the runner with a little soft touch is Drew Gilton. Out of Rapid City, South Dakota, Jank BTs to the rim, and we'll have a shot at three.
And if I'm the Fury, I would put her down low more often. She seems to have that height and length that should be exploited against this North Tartan club.
And she's been exploiting it as a member of Edina's roster for the last few years. Started as a freshman and has continued that role since. And again, this is a different style of play than what she's used to at Edina. Edina, and you still got a couple teams like this, one of those deliberate teams that make use of the lack of a shot clock, as the officials are having a discussion with the scores table. I don't know what's going on.
I saw one of the scores table's officials holding up a five. I don't know why. Seems too early for that.
Maybe a clock issue? Or is there a score issue? It's 34-25, and the score is accurate. Okay, we'll play on. If someone knows what happened, send me a comment. Jink missing the free throw. She's up to 10, though. It's been quite a battle between her and Mikayla Hayes in the post today.
You know, I would expect to see that featured more, to be honest.
Backus for three.
Because they both seem like very skilled players, and I would expect to see you use your best skilled players.
Well, we know Hayes is going D1. I'm not sure where Jank is going, but she may have a college in her future. Foul before the shot. It's on 11, Monahan. Side out for the Fury. Here's Jank with a shovel pass to Schaub, and she switches it.
That was a really nice play.
Oh, like what you said, involving Jank more on the offensive side, and that time she used herself as a pick.
Absolutely, that was a great play. And Schaub was smart enough to come behind it and get an open look.
Sarda, can it from the corner. And Jank with the rebound. Fury, not giving up easily. Theuninck passes out to Jank.
What great passing.
Unable to hit the three, though, was Wheatcraft. Monahan on the other end, no foul called. Rebound Jank. Used up the dribble and finds Schaub.
20 officials in the crowd wanted a foul on that. But they did not get their call, their wish.
Theuninck missing the three-pointer. Monahan bounces to nobody. And Wheatcraft will get the steal. She intended to pass to Sarda, but they didn't quite cut correctly, and no three-pointer there. And that's an over-the-back foul on Sarda.
Great box out. Collecting the over and back, over the back call.
That was Danielle Schaub, all 5 feet, 5 inches. Height or lack thereof runs in the Schaub family, but they're known as feisty defenders, and here come the platoon subs again. Well, there's one thing that I guess I enjoy with the high school ranks, it's fewer platoon subs. But this has been an enjoyable showcase, getting to see a lot of great talent from the high school ranks.
And we've had the best game saved for last today in the three games we've covered.
And if I can convince you to, well, we've got a foul on Sarda here. If I can convince you to join me for any high school games, you'll be more prepared next year when we run into some of these names.
At least I better be.
Danninger avoids the 5-second call, and they're going to try the play for Wierke.
Nice.
To throw the pass into a bunch of trees and a jump ball. North Tartan with the arrow. North Tartan trying to wrap up this AAU state championship with a pair of championships, winning the 10th grade division, hoping to do the same here in the 11th grade division.
Building on that strong tradition. And showing that it's worth the drive, wherever you're coming from.
All right, they're getting players out of Wisconsin, South Dakota, Iowa. They've got the whole Midwest down.
And I think we look
at
least
the bordering states.
And if I think we look at their roster, it's all over the Twin Cities.
Johnson drains the three. Raina Johnson.
I get
the
feeling she just got subbed back into the game and she's already on fire. Ooh.
And Fiore throws it away. Danninger can't hook up with Jank. 37-27, North Tartan up by 10 with 11:44 to play. This time it's back is going up. I think she was blocked from behind, but she tips the O-board to Johnson. And Johnson ultimately loses the ball. Danninger is blocked by Moschkow.
Oh, and they're saying Danninger touch it last.
So Moschkow's block results in a turnover.
Got a steal here.
And the finish for Tori Martell, number 12 for the Fury. I tried to figure out where Raina Johnson is from. I don't know if I'm going to have much success because there's a Raina Johnson who is a Miss Wisconsin from a couple years ago. So I'll have to work a little harder next time. But the Fury trying to answer back. Jank draws a foul. And if that's on Johnson, that's her fourth.
Nope. They are not going to call it on Johnson. They're going to call that on Moschkow.
And I realized I misspelled Raina's name on my Google search, so I can tell you where she's from. St. Michael-Albertville. And she has committed to Iowa State, where she'll join the likes of T.T. Starks, who is in attendance today. She won't get a chance to play alongside Shauna Johnson, Johnson being a senior. And then who made both free throws there for? It was Danninger for the Fury. So that should give her 2 points then, shouldn't it? Raina Johnson missing the three-pointer.
Lost my spot, sorry.
You put the emphasis on the wrong syllable, metaphorically speaking.
Every now and then I find myself listening to you and not paying attention enough to. I'm watching the
listening
game.
Listening to my endless fountain of knowledge.
Yes.
Baseline J is good
by Robson.
For Robson. That puts her up to 5. Martell in trouble. Johnson guarding her. Get out of it through Schaub. The bounce pass to Nibbelink. The turnaround move is rejected by Gilton. And we're going North Tartan's direction. They lead by 9 with 10:05 to play in regulation in our last game in the AAU state tournament.
Good job by the North Tartan defender not to be fooled by the head fake.
3 on the way is good. Robson again.
That's what I was talking about. She can shoot the 3.
You weren't kidding. Theuninck will shoot 2. She draws a foul on Gilton, or Robson. Theuninck out of Mankato, Loyola. led the state in scoring last year, was among the leaders as a sophomore. Imagine she'll be one of the big names to follow next year on the prep scene. She splits there. That puts her up to four. Monahan tried to get the touch pass, couldn't do so. And Nortartan will call a timeout to get his team, or get their team out of a jam.
I was thinking right on that drive, it would have been a bounce pass would have been beautiful. You do the straight person-to-person pass, the defender puts their hand out and blocks it, but a bounce pass would have been right under that arm, would have allowed their teammate to have a layup.
9:34 left in the second half, and Nortartan up 42-31. One more trophy to be awarded, and as the full slate of games wrapping up here on the campus of Bloomington Jefferson, a little warm, of course. It is mid-80s out there, and this gym doesn't have AC, but it would feel a lot warmer if there were windows.
They do have the back door open, I think.
I feel a draft in here. Now, a very fine facility to host this event, and we said it's nice that they have. Oh, nice entry feed and a traveling violation. Robson took a few too many steps. That was a great feed, too.
She knew she was going to get hit, so I think she tried to take the hit and move and get that layup and get the and one.
Tried to do a little too much there?
I don't know. I wasn't sure she shuffled her feet, but I'm not wearing a striped shirt.
Have you ever tried wearing a striped shirt?
I have. One year for Halloween, my daughter and I were replacement refs.
And that's the extent of your officiating career, I take it.
That's the extent of my officiating career.
Bullseye.
That was a nice shot.
Ellie Guess with her second tray. Puts her up to six. And the Fury have been getting some baskets to kind of hang around, but they haven't been able to draw closer than 7 or 8 points. There's a deflection by Riley Wheatcraft. It will stay with Nortartan. Bounce pass for Sexe. Nobody was on her, and Sexe with an easy layup. They completely forgot about Sexe on the weak side. Jank for three. Off the mark. Rebound Ranke.
I have no doubt she can make that shot, but I'd really want her inside and use the outside shooters for the three. And do exactly what Nortartan just did.
Who scored that, Monahan?
I think so, but I'm not sure.
Unofficially, we'll give that bucket to Monahan. Largest lead of the game at 13. And the Fury throw it away. Theuninck and Danninger will return to the floor for the Fury.
Kind of wondering if the Fury would call a timeout right now to say, because you can start to feel the separation happening, and you do not want that to happen. But they got a steal here, so they can get two more. Oh, she's going to get the charge. Yep, she dropped her shoulder. I saw it happening.
And I'm not sure Wheatcraft needed to do that.
She did not.
But Ranke doesn't mind. It's always good to draw a charge.
Absolutely.
Sarda bouncing to Sexe. No. Rebound Jank. Skirting the baseline, but Guess couldn't put it in.
That was a very interesting offhand scoop attempt.
I don't know how close she got to the baseline, but could have been more than a few millimeters.
I wasn't sure she stayed in bounds.
Sarda, now it's Ranke with a triple.
Oh, that's interesting.
Ranke with her first tray of the game, and Ranke and Eastview as a whole known for their distance shooting and their fundamentals. That's what got them a state championship in 2014. Danninger to Jank, corner three. Off the mark. Rebound Monahan. Ranke on the fast break. Had to put on the brakes, and that cost her. Stopped herself in an awkward position to avoid the traveling violation, and that messed her up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, tried to switch hands on the shot, too, all at the same time.
Sarda over to Monahan. Tried to set it up to a cutting Sarda. It was last touched by the Fury. Eden Nibbelink will return, giving Wheatcraft a breather. Nibbelink, a player we might see next year out of Winona. They graduated a talented player. Hallie Heppner. Sarda, runner is short. Sexe with the O board. Short on the putback, gets her own miss, and will shoot two. The foul on Jank. Sexe, along with Tomes at Eastridge, the only two players to average double figures for the Raptors, although Eastridge's offense doesn't necessarily pile on points. But they've been a consistent group over the years and would love to get that first state tournament appearance. White Bear Lake has gotten in their way in the last couple of years. Sexe makes both free throws, and looks like North Tartan is pulling away here, up by 18 with 6:34 in regulation. And that's another offensive foul. This one on Theuninck.
Pressing a little. Pressing and trying just to get out of your flow. Don't get excited, just calm down. Don't push.
And we've seen this pattern in the three games we've covered today. Close first half, and then the more dominant team, or superior team, for lack of a better phrase, seems to pull away in the second. But as we noted, you look at the depth of North Tartan, it's tough to stop. Up and under move by Ranke is strong, and the rebound goes to Danninger. Minnesota Fury got it to within four midway through the first half, and then North Tartan finished the half on a scoring burst of their own. And the Fury just look disorganized here.
Yeah, they look a little rattled.
Wierke will return to the floor in place of Jank.
I'd like to see something come from the Fury, like what we saw with 43 Hoops, where they made a valiant effort in the second half to come back and get into the game, because there's a lot to learn from both sides. If you start pressing and you can't execute, I don't know what you're really building on. You're just kind of getting frustrated and kind of unraveling. You'd like to see them collected together and then focus. I don't know if that means coach needs to call timeout. Talk about that. That's the kind of thing I might want to do if I was coaching. Hey, let's talk about this, guys. Let's get this back together. We can still get in this game.
D.D. Winston missing the front end. The only player from the North Tartan 11th grade team to not score yet. As we noted, Winston out of Hopkins. Finished second in the 4A championship in March. Won it last year, and now every player has scored for North Tartan.
And again, talking about their depth and distribution. And who can hurt you? Pretty much everybody.
How would you like to draw? Whoa! Eden Nibbelink with a turnaround hook. Use some glass there.
That's a highlight if you make it, and a scolding if you don't.
Sarda stepped on the line. I was going to say, imagine drawing up the scouting report against a team like North Tartan or some of the deeper teams in high school.
I think
you had to write this up. So who can hurt you? Well, everyone.
Let's focus on
us.
When you say, let's focus on us.
You'd say, that sounds daunting.
Or play a good team game. Make sure you're communicating. Make sure you're talking.
And Nibbelink has scored back-to-back buckets for Fury. She got the pass from Wierke. Winston, with a full burst of speed, finds Hayes. And Hayes struggling down low. Timeout, North Tartan. Not a strong game for Mikayla Hayes today. I don't know how many looks have come up short, but thankfully, she's had a lot of help, and Eden Nibbelink, before she made those baskets, had not scored in this game.
And I think that last timeout was a good example of the coach practicing calling a timeout in a scrambling situation. They certainly didn't need the timeout, but it's good to sit there and focus and make sure you finish strong. I think this timeout actually helps the Fury as well. Okay, guys, this is when we need to collect ourselves. Let's collect what we're doing. You can see the coach putting his hands in a circle. High five in. Let's do this.
Well, and the ball was loose, so I can understand calling a timeout.
Yep. I mean, but realistically, the coach could easily say this game's ours.
Well, and we...
the clock run.
There's another sighting I want to highlight. You can't see it on here, but we talked about Eastview and their fundamentals. The architect of that is in attendance now. Madison Giebert, who's now at South Dakota State, won the first round game in the NCAA championship this past year.
Yeah, that was a great story this year to see them doing well.
There were a lot of upsets outside of UConn in the women's bracket this year, and when someone finally catches to UConn, maybe that will bode well for the sport. Of course, when you win and win the way UConn has, that pretty much dominates the conversation.
You have to respect the fact that they can get it done.
That's true. And the way they've gotten it done over the last few years, too.
And they're setting an example of how to set up a program and how to continue to work at your program and not ever be complacent and keep driving.
And that's what UCLA did for so many years back in the 70s.
Mm-hmm.
4:27 left in regulation. It's a 15-point margin. Hayes sends Wierke out the door. Metaphorically.
Yeah, tried to do a little bit of a scoop shot, and Hayes was not interested in that.
Scoop shot's not going to work against a player of Hayes' caliber. You got to go up. And they throw it away. DeeDee Winston on the fast break. Comes up short. But Gilton is there.
Backus was set up for the three, had her hands ready and everything. There we go.
Or they'll go back door, and DeeDee Winston with her first field goal. So every player on North Tartan has made at least one field goal now.
And that happened because of a team play. Team group play with good passing.
Foul on Winston. Out of fouls to give, North Tartan is. So Martell will shoot the front end of a 1-1, but North Tartan up comfortably here, 55-38. And Backus gets the board after Martell misses the front end.
And those 1-1 elusive points just are not easy to get.
Well, when they go to college, they won't have to worry about that. As you know, they changed the rules to be more reflective of professional ball now, WNBA included. So they have to put up with this for one more year.
I think they'll also be spending more time practicing the free throws.
Probably. But when you look back at this game, it's hard to single out one North Tartan player, and all of them have distinguished prep careers already. Some maybe more famous than others just because of the amount of headlines they get, but I know all the Minnesota players could find college offers by the time they graduate this time next year, and nice to see some new faces like Gilton and Monahan. And I was going to say back in the first half, that's a big commitment. I imagine maybe they have family here. Maybe the family just puts in that effort as Wierke finishes the high-low play from Nibbelink. And not just North Tartan, but elsewhere too, to come from wherever you happen to be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're coming from Western Wisconsin, it's not that bad of a drive. But if you're coming from Iowa, you know, there's a commute involved.
There's a very big
you're spending an entire weekend, so I imagine some of them may have to skip school for this.
Mm-hmm.
No, that impresses me. Say what you will about AAU and its impact on basketball, positive or negative, but it says something when you can get players from outside the state. DeeDee Winston missing the three-pointer there. Hayes draws coverage.
Well, I think that's especially true when you look at, we've seen the squad and platoon subbing, which means you're doing a lot of work for maybe not as much time as you might get back home, so that's a big deal.
Not to mention the playing time you would get at the high school team.
Right.
or most of these players on North Tartan and on the Fury are starters and probably log 25 to 30 minutes.
So here they're giving that up.
When they need to, you know, outside of those blowout games.
Right.
North Tartan simply running out clock here. Well, Dee Dee Winston on the drive, and how many layups have we seen come up short today? Or at least not go in. Nibbelink for three. Off the rim.
Nice cut.
Martell tried to scoop it, but with you got 6-1 Hayes down there, so Nibbelink will take a deep three instead, and that's short. And the rebound to Ranke. Well, did you have fun coming in blindly here to this event?
Yeah, this is fun. It was fun. We had to see a lot of good players. Trying to think about what I could say. Well, we didn't really get three great games, but we did get to see a lot of great players. And
we can't control that. I'm sure if you and I could, we'd have a 90 to 85 nail biter.
I don't know if I could keep up with that much, but we saw some great defense, and we're seeing certainly the future of high school basketball on display this weekend.
Winston scoring. Less than a minute to play now. And going to what you said, you go from your high school team where you practice and play with each other for 3 months nonstop as Wheatcraft gets a layup. Here you mix it up. You might get some practice here and there, but you're mixing it up with players you may not be as familiar with. And as we've seen in all-star games at the high school level, it takes a little while to adjust.
Well, especially, it depends. If you're a position player, maybe it's not as uncomfortable or foreign, but if you are like working in a system where you've got a good solid unit, it is kind of interesting when you take yourself out of it. So it is it's probably a good thing for the future, because when they go to college, they're going to have to do the same thing. They're going to become a different part of a different unit, and when they get there, they're going to be the low person on the totem pole. So they're dribbling out the game.
If they give it to the official and
they handed it,
Reiki's like, I don't. Ranke didn't even want to bother with the last 8 seconds. Like, here, you take it.
Yeah, I don't think I've seen that before, where you prematurely hand it to the official. And
well, the official is technically in play. They are in the field of play. That was Tim Senshin, by the way, who spent a lot of time coaching, and also had a daughter who went to college. Stephanie went to Air Force, and I believe finished up at Green Bay. So wanted to get that in there. 57-42, the final. North Tartan wins the junior division in the AAU state championship, and that concludes our coverage here from the 2016 AAU State Championship. I don't know if we can tabulate the numbers here, but North Tartan, I don't think there was a single player. Lindsey Robson had 9 points. Winston had some points late. She had 5. I can tell you that every player got at least one field goal. And you're just touting up the half numbers here. And I don't think anybody, there was no 10-point score.
I don't think so.
We got to get a shot of this done adding up.
No, we don't.
Well, maybe this might be a little easier to tabulate. The notables for Fury, Annika Jank finishing with 11 points. And she was your only double-digit scorer from the Fury, but it came down to defense and really just not a lot of shots going in. As you noted, Fury also taking a lot of three balls that missed. And there was no 10-point score, the highest.
Looks
a
like
pair of eights.
A pair of eights?
Mariah Sexe and Lindsey Robson.
I'd have to add it all up.
That doesn't happen often where you don't get a double-digit score, and on a team with
57 points.
11 players, everyone scored and got a basket. So
that's a wow.
If that isn't balanced, I don't know what is. Your final thoughts, though, Don, as we wrap things up here?
I'm trying to do math.
You're trying to do math.
No, like I said earlier, good games.
We do 3 games, and Don's takeaway, I'm trying to do math.
My takeaway, actually really impressed by the depth on the North Tartan team.
Among the 3 games I covered today, I think the most outstanding performance came from Raina Suggs in that sophomore game. Of course, it's really hard to stand out, much like the Lynx of the last few years. It's hard to stand out when you have so many weapons.
Yeah, and I think earlier we did see a pretty impressive performance by
Callie Tyson.
Tyson and Purcell, they both had a dominant game in that first game for Crossfire.
Division, or the freshman division, so. Yeah. Well, perhaps we'll have to bring you back next year when you can get your math skills in order.
Yeah, I might have to practice it during the off season.
Well, we'll have a long off season. Well, and there's also link season, too, so you can use that for practice.
I could try. Thank you.
But the high score, as we mentioned, Annika Jank with 11 points for the Fury, and Ellie Guess had 6, and Sydney Wierke had 6. But a lot of fun as they go through the trophy presentation for the last two teams here. And as we finish that up, we'd like to thank you for watching our triple header here at Bloomington Jefferson High School. And for our entire crew, Don Ackerman, I'm Mike Peden. Thank you for watching. We hope to see you next year.
Thank you very much.